recently, I just realized that our Secretary General, Dr. Shuja Shafi's piece that he wrote recently, this weekend, is on the back of your booklet. And I was thinking, if you have that, what's the purpose of me sitting, standing here and saying it again anyway? Because almost everything that I probably will say is in that article. But I suppose that shows that what I say here is what we believe and we live as an institution, as an organization. And of course I stand before you today at a time when Muslims in the UK, in Europe, and perhaps across the world find themselves in a very difficult situation. Difficult in the sense that we are proud to be who we are, but at the same time there seems to be a sense that we have to constantly justify our presence. And it doesn't matter whether you're in England or you are in Iraq or Syria, you constantly seem to have to justify that what you stand for is peaceful, what you stand for is a true message of Islam. You constantly have to distance yourself. And yet I wonder, why does it have to be like that? There are many different communities, many different faiths, and all have its own history. Good and bad. So why have to stand here just because some lunatic decides to do certain things? But then again, we live in real world, and people perceive things, people form their views, and we all have a duty to make sure that the views and perceptions that exist in our society are well-founded, are based on real information. And it is really in that spirit that I stand here, and I'll try my best to kind of speak in a celebratory mode, because I do note that this session is to celebrate diversity and to stand up to racism. So I will try to be, if you like, upbeat, to be celebratory, to be positive, and to be hopeful about the future. Perhaps the three incidents that stick up in our mind most prominently are, if you like, the Charlie Hebdo and the whole notion that came following it. And then, of course, the Chapel Hill, most recently in the US, and then Copenhagen. And for me, what it shows is that it doesn't matter what faith you are, it doesn't matter whether you have any faith, it doesn't matter what color you are, we all are at risk. We all are at risk of being subjected to force and violence by fanatics. And all that they have in common is not so much about the faith or religion or color of these perpetrators, but they all are motivated by hate. And so for me, all these people, whether it's religious, Islamically inspired, or an Islamist fundamentalist terrorist, or a fascist terrorist, they're all for me are same. They all are driven by hate. Not by faith, not by cultural identity, not by their racial identity, but by hate. And it is because of the hatred that they do what they do. But some of the things that I want to focus on is that we talked about these three narratives, and yet if you look at the media, you can instantly see, if you actually observe the media, not just see it because it's there in your living room, but if you actually observe the media, the coverage and the way the media portray various incidents are quite different. I know one of Marwan Muhammad spoke earlier, so I don't want to go too far on this. But if you look at this, Chapel Hill, for example, initially wasn't even covered. It had to be one Erdogan to really raise the game for others to take interest. And I think it's quite unfortunate, because Erdogan should not be our standard bearer in terms of how we want to demonstrate what we do and what we choose to do. But then also, if you look at it, there may be many violences where the perpetrators are Muslim, and often the victims are also largely Muslim. But Muslims have no monopoly over violence or violent traffic. As we speak, there is essentially a cleansing going on in Central African Republic. We hardly hear about it. Muslims are essentially being wiped out in Central African Republic. Just for performing your faith, even in Muslim countries, where I come from, Bangladesh, for example, if you are a bearded man with a traditionally religiously garment, you could be in trouble with authorities and so on. So it doesn't matter where you are, Muslims are as much, if not more, of a victim of terrorism and violence as any other communities. And yet, if you follow the media, it seems as if the Muslims are perpetrating all of this. and really taking everybody else as, if you like, the victims, the captives.
And yet that's not true. And what is really, really troubling, I think, is that how, or because they want to capitalize on it, the politicians seems also, not everybody, but the driving force within the mainstream politics seems to either come or, you know, or because they want to capitalize on this media narrative, they seem to also join the bandwagon. And some of the examples, I mean, if you take the counter-terrorism and security bill, I couldn't believe on the 800th year of Magna Carta, in our parliament, there will be cross-party consensus for, you know, this kind of bill. Why? Because we have this narrative that somehow Muslims are, if you like, coming to us. I'm mindful of the time, so I will move to some positives. At the heart of the coverage of Muslim, it seems to me, is that somehow we are seen as the other, as the foreigner. You know, and yet that's not true. That's not true. Only a week ago, the Muslim Council of Britain published a report called Muslims in Numbers, and it was widely covered in the media. It was based on data collected by the Census 2011. What it showed is that there are almost 250,000 Muslims who are white British. Half of the Muslim population are born here, and about three-quarters of them believe, you know, identify themselves as British. So we are not foreign. We are not here immigrant in the sense we have just come. People like me, my generation, my next generation, my children, my siblings, they are as much British as anybody else. So this notion, whenever we're spoken as if the other, we have to really stand up to it. But it doesn't end there. Another notion is that somehow we are a drain to the wider society. Again, that is not true. That is not true. The Muslim contribution to British economy is at least £30 billion a year, at least. And it doesn't stop there. In London, 1,000 of the small businesses are owned by Muslims, which creates over 80,000 jobs. And I can go on and on and on. But the point really I want to conclude on is that we all are united in a, you know, we all have common aspirations to do good, to succeed in life. We all have common aspirations to be respected, to respect, to live in peace, and to let the others live in peace. And therefore, it would be wrong of us to allow, not, it would be wrong for us to subscribe to that notion of us and them, but it would also be wrong for us to be silent when those kind of notions, those kind of narrative is fed into our public discourse. And that is why I think initiative like this, organization like the UAF, I'm so proud to be associated with, because it's this initiative that gives us cause to be hopeful. It gives us a sense of pride, and if you like, inspire us to work even harder. So again, thank you very much for allowing this wonderful opportunity, and every year I come here, I really feel inspired because it gives you hope to see a mixed group of people from all walks of life and some pioneers as well. You know, and that really energizes and strengthens our resolve to continue work for the best. So thank you once again.